So this is exactly the response that I fear, that you know, in a culture and heritage which had perhaps one of the greatest philosophers, philosophical traditions and scientific traditions, we are today in a stage where the only the greatest imitation of the science which surely the West leads in are worthy of you know, prizes either within India and outside India. In fact, the last, I don't even remember his name, but you know, he, I'm sure he's worthy of remembering, because the last scientist who got the Nobel Prize was he must be from Andhra. I forget his name. Was really irritated when people said he's an Indian, and he grew up in this. He said, "Look, I mean, what the hell are you talking about? Everything that I am today, I owe to my American university. And please, you know, don't bother with trying to say that, you know, I'm from some little village in Andhra." So, I mean, imitation in the, amongst the sciences where the mind is required is the most appreciated and awarded today. No alternative science person, you know, you can see, just see the fights on this thing. They're just called, they're, you know, next to black magic men.
Let me make a quick response. I think we are getting into many areas of discussion and is leading us nowhere. I think Shakti's point was raised a valid point. But I think the terms used are a bit confusing. Imitation, adaptation, I think the line is not very clear. Actually, you have to imitate first before you can absorb, master, and then you can apply your imagination. What we are talking about today is creativity. Whether it is science or in the arts, everywhere, it is creativity. The question you are asking is, why have we stopped being creative? And somehow in our mind, there is a monster called globalization which is responsible. I would urge you to think, globalization is an economic phenomenon. It is not attacking your mind. It is creating an environment in which you are physically more comfortable and standards of living are rising and so on. But nobody says that because you are more affluent, you should not think independently. So far, scientists are not inventing new things. And if they find that in the United States there is a better environment for them, so be it. Why be so anxious about it? But let us find out how we can emphasize on creativity here. But the fact is, creativity can't be manufactured. You create the conditions for it. You can set up your national science laboratories. You can give fancy salaries and appoint scientists, but you may not get results. So we have to think of why we have reached a stage of barrenness in many areas. But at the same time, you can't ignore that creativity is taking place in a lot of fields. In the field of arts, there is tremendous creativity. In dance, in music, it's happening. Now, one more thought, madam. You raised the point. Now, why are we blaming the state for everything? Let me understand, there is an area called economics. There is an area called culture. And
all
trade.
Of them represent a state of mind, okay, and not a body. Okay. That's all I'm saying.
If we are interested in culture, we are against the state. I want to point out to you that culture has always depended on state patronage. If you didn't have prosperity in a particular kingdom, you didn't have the means by which culture could flourish. If the Cholas didn't have the right revenues, they couldn't have built those beautiful temples. You look at everywhere in India, all our great cultural icons are products of certain affluent societies where the state invested in culture. Without the state, the classical dances, as Johar said, dance and music couldn't have happened today had it not been for the support it got from the Ministry of Information and Broadcasting under Dr. B.V. Kesker through All India Radio. We've forgotten how much we owe to that period of time where the culture, cultural regeneration of India took place after independence. So let's not create this antagonism between state and culture. I think we have to work together. Sorry.
One last question from me.
I think you're bothered about Sarkar.
No,
no,
I would like Amrit to respond.
No, I think this whole issue. I work a lot with the youth.
Why don't you ask your question, then we could come in.
I work a lot with the youth. Globalization, from my understanding from these eminent speakers here today, is nothing new. It's been happening for centuries. And we have assimilated a lot from various cultures and civilizations, and in turn we have given a lot as well. And it's not something that's going to stop, it's not a bogey to be afraid of. And as Indians, we have our soft skills and culture, amazing amount of, because of, you know, it being such a diverse country, so many diverse cultures, so many dances, etc. You know, I mean, there's just no end to it, what we can exchange. And in the future, that is something to look forward to. So an exchange can keep happening, but India can still retain its uniqueness. We can still carry on passing it to the future generations. My question to you is, since I work a lot with the youth, and we're doing a lot of performing arts, and you know, we kind of amalgamate the Western and the Indian, we try to keep passing on. I just want advice on how you can advise us to carry it on in a better way.
See, this is the voice I mentioned to you. You've got it. Everything is okay. But, you know, that is also, I think we have to somewhere decide that everything is not okay also. That's all I'm saying. It's not cynicism. It's actually a great hope which makes you say that. Otherwise, we keep quiet. This dialogue that she started is because we have a lot of hope that there's somewhere things are not okay. And that's what the practitioners of the arts have mentioned. She's a teacher, Shakti is a painter, Siddharth is a filmmaker. They have mentioned the issue of imitation and copy, and they feel it. None of us here are practitioners, if I may say so, you know, on the panel, I mean. So sometimes as administrators and teachers, we should listen to the voice of the practitioner more. Even though we have to make sense of it and bring the mind into the world of practice, we have to listen to them because every area has its area of practice. And I think there is a problem somewhere. What it is needs to be identified, as you say, in future dialogues. Thank you very much.
Just one thing, how are we supposed to handle the How are we going to
I would just like to thank our country itself, as was referred by Punjab as agriculture. So thanks to globalization, where it was okay if I listened to Michael Jackson or Madonna, but if I put up my interest as a Punjabi, as a Sadarni in Carnatic music, or Midangam, or Bharatanatyam, I was questioned, how come? I mean, what will you understand in that? How would you do that? So I would say globalization is like opening up the mind, the horizon, and accepting the unknown. I think the question of imitating, and it is more coming from rigidity and fear for the unknown. And I would really like to thank Lalit ji for saying that globalization is about really widening the horizon. And,
can I be allowed a question? I just wanted to make two quick observations, and that can be a question also. We've been talking, I've been listening very intently, not patiently, but intently, is that we've talked about either or. Nothing is either or. The room you're sitting in today has a lot of Western things. Right? If we can use them, I think she was absolutely right when she said that we need to use them wisely. Importance is to use that differentiation. What is good for us and what is not good. And that's an individual choice. Culture is always, sold, I learned this way, by people in power. Culture, culture, let's get the fundas clear. The second aspect is when we talk about, I was talking about the science. We have 5,000 or more than 5,600, if I remember correctly, application in the National Innovation Council of India, where people from small towns have come out with incredible innovations, and we are sleeping over it. What if you talk about creativity? When a guy at, let's say, in a village in Rajasthan makes a refrigerator at 300 rupees, and he's not rewarded.
Yeah.
It's not that what we are saying is not happening. It's happening, but we are choking the system. Our processes are not looking at inculcating those values to redefine and let the person soar like an eagle. It's very easy to say culture ki problem hai. I think the problem is ours is I remember a movie, Ek Doctor Ki Maut, and some of you must have seen that, in which a guy from Calcutta, a scientist, he actually had to shelf off a project in which he would have got a Nobel Prize. I think the only globalization, I am sorry, in India we have is eating the Western food, wearing the apparels,
yeah,
and talking in an accent,
yes,
and looking at the AXN movies.
I agree.
Right? What we need is an age of Ferrari, and most of us, including me, ride the metal bullet car. Thank you.
And Jugaad.
Thank you all for a very vibrant question and answer session. I just wanted to make a couple of one request. Kindly leave your names and numbers in the visitors book so that we stay in touch and are able to invite you to our next event. The next event that we are having is on June 12th, which is the screening of a film, Wo Subah Kidhar Nikalti, by Tripurari Saran. You're all invited, and entry is free. Please bring friends along if you wish to. And I would like to thank all of you for being here. 12th of June. Thank you, Dr. Srinivasan. Thank you, Shantanji. Thank you, Ambassador Mansingh. Thank you, Mr. Johan Sardar. You've made this evening very lively and educative. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.